Good morning, everyone. Welcome to a new edition of Arts Beat TV and Radio here on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15, 89.5 FM WSKB, and our media partners at Agawa Media and Southwick Community Television. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach, and with us today, Jennifer Berman and Robert Hoyle from Harmonia 5, a woodwind quintet who will be opening the Springfield Chamber Players Moso Chamber Music Series in Longmeadow at the First Church on the Green on December 3rd at 3 p.m. And they'll be doing a holiday concert. Jennifer Berman and Robert Hoyle, it's great to see both of you.
Good to see you again, Mark.
So Jennifer, you guys came up here, I guess you made your Massachusetts debut with the Moso Springfield Chamber Players last spring at the Westfield Athenaeum, and you did primarily a French program. So on this program, which is more of a holiday motif, what are some of the things that you're going to be doing?
Well, we kind of are mixing the two halves up a little bit, where the second half will be all holiday music. The first half is going to have an American theme, where not like patriotic or anything, but American composers. And the very first one we'll be playing is Valerie Coleman Umoja, which is actually, it actually fits with the seasonal theme in that it's a piece about the first day of Kwanzaa. That opens the show, and then we'll have works on the first half by George Gershwin. We have a Porgy and Bess suite that is an amazing arrangement that we love to play. And the third piece on the first half is by Rick Sowash, who is a composer that we came to know because he often would summer in Connecticut. And we've grown to be pretty close with him, and he's even written us some pieces over the years. So we're going to play his piece called Three American Perennials. So it's not just an American composer, but an American piece as well.
And then the second half swings into more of the holiday-themed kind of music.
Right. So we will hit the ground running with the Nutcracker Suite, which is five movements from the ballet. And of course, that's always fun, and everyone enjoys that. And we found a great arrangement by Bill Holcomb, who he's a composer and arranger who's done a lot of stuff for Woodwind Quintet, and he always does really fun arrangements that are interesting for every player in the group. So he has put together a festival of Hanukkah melodies, that we're going to be playing. And we'll end the show with Christmas carols, so we can have a sing-along if people are in the mood. And hopefully we'll have one other surprise piece in there. We're just waiting for the ink to dry on the arrangement. So that's something that will be announced later.
Now, are holiday concerts part of what Harmonia 5 does regularly, or did you put this together for Longmeadow?
We put it together for Longmeadow, although in the past we did a concert for that was presented by Orchestra New England, where we did holiday music that was arranged for woodwind quintet and harpsichord, which was a lot of fun. So that was a couple of selections from the Nutcracker as well. And then the 12 Days of Christmas, there was an arrangement that we did, and it was narrated as well. So there was a little... there were little verses that went with each movement, but it's not something that we normally do, the holiday program. So this is going to be a fun change for us.
And it's a beautiful venue. It's just so perfect for the holiday type of concert. Mosso did a concert there last year, right around Christmas, and it snowed during the concert. So when the concert was over, it was about 3:30 in the afternoon. There was a fresh coating of snow, and it's on the town green with the Christmas tree and stuff in it. Talk about putting you in the holiday mood. It's just a gorgeous, gorgeous hall.
Well, we can't wait to play there. This has been a great year for us as far as playing in new places, new venues. So we love to discover the new concert halls and churches and auditoriums all over, you know, New England. It's we've played in some new places this year in Woodbury, Connecticut, for the first time on the Woodbury Bethlehem series down there. Actually, after the new year, we'll be doing a couple of concerts in Pennsylvania in January and April. And those are two places that the group has played about a decade ago. They played there, but we haven't been back since. So I'm looking forward to heading out to a different, a far away state, it seems like.
And we should tell people that if you're interested in getting tickets for this December 3rd concert in Longmeadow, it's family friendly, by the way, certainly something you could bring the kids to. Tickets are available at SpringfieldSymphonyMusicians.com. And I think we've got Bob Hoyle, who is one of the members of the quintet, online with volume. Can you hear us, Bob?
Yes, I can. Can you hear me now?
We can. Yes. So
excellent. Finally.
Finally, Bob.
I've had the technical difficulties here, and I think I've got them straightened out finally. So you have my apologies.
That's fine. And we got to say that Bob Hoyle is one of the reasons that Harmonia 5 is performing with the Springfield Chamber Players. He's a member of the Springfield Symphony Orchestra, and he introduced us to his quintet. And as I said earlier in the program, they were a big hit at the Westfield Athenaeum last spring. So I am personally gratified to know that you're going to open the Springfield Chamber Players Longmeadow series on December 3rd.
Well, we're really happy to be there. I played there, I did this concert there last year, but with a brass quintet. And it's a fabulous, fabulous place to play in. The sound is absolutely beautiful there. And we had a very large audience, and it was just absolutely thrilling. So I'm really glad to be back.
It's good to have you back. So from last April, when you were in Westfield, to now, Jennifer said that you played in some new venues and new locations. What are some of the programs that you've taken out and done in the last 6 months?
Well, that's a good question. And to be honest, we've been through a lot of repertoire these past several months. We played... Let's see. Let's go back to the summer. We played down in New Canaan, Connecticut. Now, Jennifer, help me out. What was the name of the mansion where we played? Do you remember?
You're talking about Ridgefield?
Yeah. Oh, Ridgefield. Right. Excuse me. Not New Canaan.
That was Lounsbury House.
Right. Lounsbury House. And we did a bit of a popsy program. It was all movie music. And of course, you know, the piece we started off with was Jennifer's possibly favorite movie, Raiders of the Lost Ark. And
not possibly, it's my favorite.
It is absolutely her favorite. Okay. But I think the piece that really went over the very best, and this was a little surprising to me, although it is wonderful music, was we have a collection of pieces from The Sound of Music. And so we played that actually got a standing ovation. So it really was a lot of fun to do. We also did an interesting one in a park in New Canaan. They had built a very nice new pavilion in this park. And Gwyneth Walker, who is a composer who lives in New Canaan, she wrote a piece for us to be premiered at the official opening of this pavilion. And what we did was we gave a bit of a preview concert there for a small invited audience. And I have to say, first of all, it was just a perfect day. Clear blue skies, 70 degrees. It was just beautiful. It was off in the woods. And so when we would play, I remember walking back to my car to get something. And as I was coming back towards the pavilion, just the sound of the music resonating through the forest was just magical. And so we played that piece there, and that went really quite well. And so we're going to be performing that. We'll have the official premiere of that this summer at the same venue. Let's see, where else have we played? We just did Jennifer, did you mention the concert we just did at Wesleyan University in Middletown, Connecticut?
Not yet.
Yeah, that was a very interesting one. I teach on and off at Wesleyan, and one of my colleagues there, who he's actually retired and now is a professor emeritus, Neely Bruce, approached us to perform a piece by, is it Richard Winslow?
Mm-hmm.
Who passed away several years back, but was a leading member of Wesleyan's faculty for many, many, many years. The first piece we did, actually the pieces were first woodwind quintet and soprano. The first piece we did was called The Last Page of Finnegan's Wake, where he set the last page to music. Then there was a small, very short bridge piece, which was Abide By Me, set for soprano and woodwind quintet. And then the major piece, where we went right into it, was simply called Abide. And this was an experimental minimalist piece where we were simply playing long tone chords, and it would just change very, very minutely every several bars, while the singer sang very, very, very slowly the song Abide By Me. And when she sung the short version of it, it was, I don't know, was it 17 bars long? It was very, very quick. Then when we got into the longer version, it was about a half hour long. And so you would find it to be either fascinating or very tedious. And we were afraid it was going to be tedious. However, I did find it really quite fascinating. There were some sound colors that the composer got in this that were just really mind-bending. And so it ended up being a lot more enjoyable than I thought than I was afraid it might be. So
don't forget the dancers too.
Ah, yes, 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 yes. How could I forget that? You know, I always forget everything. But don't laugh too hard, Jen. yeah, they choreographed it with two dancers who would. Oh my goodness, the motion in this was just unbelievably slow and just moving like this the entire time.
And it took a lot of control.
Oh, unbelievable control. And I thought to myself afterwards, those dancers must have muscles of steel.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, you know, I mentioned that to them afterwards and they say, yeah, this steel is really, really tired.
I bet that's a challenge. I mean, Do you guys get to work with dancers often, or was this a one-time thing?
Actually, this was a one-time thing. Although it was Wesleyan, so you know, almost anything goes at Wesleyan. Neely did say it's not the first time that we had been there, but Professor Bruce, you know, he made it very clear that he would have us back. He has other projects in mind. And so in any case, the concert was very, very well received. The audience was very enthusiastic. So
Okay. And it kind of that does fit in with our, what I would call our mission statement, that we are very interested in performing works by living, you know, or very recently living composers.
How did the group get together? Were the two of you part of the original group, or did you join it after it had been created?
Bob is a founder. I am not an original member. But in our current configuration of people, we've all known each other for many, many years through playing in different orchestras and other ensembles. So it was never a case of having trouble finding the right person to fit a slot when something became open in the group. But Bob can tell you more about the beginnings if you want to hear that.
Jennifer, how long have you been with the group?
I think since 2015.
Yeah, that sounds about right. Yeah.
Yeah. So quite a while, actually.
Bob, when did you found and why did you found it?
Well, it was back in 2012. Flutist Kim Collins and I were having lunch together between rehearsals one time. And we were just talking about life and this, that, and the other thing. And she was saying to me that, you know, she really wanted to play more chamber music. You know, she's doing almost all orchestral things. And so she really would love to play more chamber music. And I said, you know, Kim, so would I. You know, I've been looking to do that. I've done a little bit of it, but I would really like to do more of it on a regular basis. So I said, what if we were to form a woodwind quintet? And she, just a huge smile came over her face and said, yeah, who would we get? And so we both came up with Janet Rosen, who's our oboist. We asked Janet if she would like to play, and she said, yes, absolutely. And then we got to thinking about clarinet players. And see, first of all, we'd have to find a player who had the availability to play. Not necessarily the best player or the best, I don't know, it's hard to say. In chamber music, you need someone who's going to fit in well with the group. And woodwind quintets are notorious for being very picky people. And so we both agreed on a clarinetist, Tom Labrador, who is a wonderful, wonderful player. He played in the Coast Guard band for many years, and he had just finished up his doctorate in performance at University of Connecticut. And he was available. He was retired from the Coast Guard. He was doing some freelancing. Then, what about bassoon? And the only person I really wanted to play with was Sue Cross, who plays in the New Haven Symphony. And Kim immediately, you know, agreed with that. So we just called all these people and asked them. And they were all very excited about it and said, yes, count me in. So that is really how we found our personnel. Now, over the years, of course, some of the personnel has changed. Sue has since retired on bassoon, and so now we have Jackie Joyner playing bassoon. She lives down in Ridgefield, Connecticut. Unfortunately, Tom Labrador passed away very unexpectedly, and that was very painful for all of us. And you know, we were actually trying to decide whether or not we were going to continue, but we decided yes. And so we had to find someone. And we all very quickly agreed on Jim Forgy, who's just a beautiful player. And he was interested, and we're very happy to have him. Then I guess the first to leave was actually Kim Collins, who was a young mother, and she was having a difficult time scheduling, you know, being free to work together, just due to her home schedule. For anyone who's a parent of young children, you know what it's like. It's difficult. And so, you know, we got to talking, well, what are we going to do? Again, we asked, we just were trying to decide whether or not to keep going. And, you know, we decided, yes, we all, this means enough to all of us. And, Jennifer's name came up, and we all thought that she would be a fabulous addition to the group. And as it turns out, she has been an indispensable addition to the group. So that's how we came together, not only in the beginning, but as we are now.
How many concerts do you do in the course of a year, Jennifer?
Over the past year, we've averaged basically one a month. We're fortunate in that some of them have been recurring for us, such as Trinity College is a place that we have played more than once in the summer. The Ridgefield Symphony has asked us back several times, usually in the summer as well. And now, of course, Springfield Chamber Players can be added to that list of recurring venues or series, I should say. But yeah, it has been a very, I would say, not too busy, but it has been a consistent working year for us, which is fabulous. I mean, the only downside to that is having to find new music sometimes, because if it's a place we've played before, we have to, we don't want to repeat ourselves too much. But that is a happy problem to have, honestly. I don't mind it.
That's a great problem to have. Got to remind people that Harmonia 5, first of all, Jennifer, tell us where people can get information about the group.
Our website is Harmonia V, the Roman numeral 5, harmoniav.com. And we're also on Facebook as well. You can just search Harmonia V Quintet.
And also for tickets for Sunday afternoon, December 3rd at 3 p.m. at the First Church of Christ on Long Meadow Street on the Green. They're being presented by the Springfield Chamber Players / Moso. It's a concert with American composers in the first half and holiday music in the second half. You can get tickets for that at SpringfieldSymphonyMusicians.com through Eventbrite, or you can buy them at the door. So great opportunity to hear some good music in a fabulous hall in Long Meadow, up and coming. We're about out of time, but I want to thank Jennifer Berman and Bob Hoyle from Harmonia 5 for being with us. And we're going to take a break to acknowledge our underwriters. We'll be back with more Arts Beat, but we'll end today's program with some music by Harmonia 5. Thanks to both of you for being here.
Thank you. Mark. And Mark, welcome back to the air.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Bob. We're going to take a break. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. I'm Mark Auerbach. We'll be back after we acknowledge the underwriters. Don't go away.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Listen to me, Michael Buster McMahon, Mondays 8 to 10 a.m. to learn the stories behind your favorite songs. Or don't. I'm not the boss of you.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to Arts Beat, everyone. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. If you've missed a part of today's program, or you want to watch it again or share it with your friends, it's archived on YouTube under WSKB Community Radio. My next guest is one of my favorite guests, Tien Huy Ng, who is the music director of the Pioneer Valley Symphony. He is on the faculty at Mount Holyoke College. He conducted the Springfield Symphony Orchestra last spring, and he's involved in all kinds of projects of new and contemporary music, classical music, all over the place. And he's coming to us today live from a parking lot in Boston, Massachusetts. He's our first guest to be on the air from a parking lot in Boston. Tian, it's good to see you.
Hi, so great to be on the show. Thank you for having me, Mark.
Yes, so what brings you to Boston today?
I am in production for a show with Whitesnake Project. The production is called Let's Celebrate, and it's celebrations of all kinds outside of the usual kind of Christmas fair that happens in the holiday season. So this year, I just had a little performance of Joe Duba Sopar by Omar Najmi, and it's a celebration with Eid. And I also performed a segment from a piece called Tamale Dumpling, which, as you can imagine, is this fusion dish of people coming together, Chinese and Mexican cultures, through food. So very exciting stuff.
And you do a lot of stuff in Boston. Didn't you just finish an opera?
I did. Also with Whitesnake Project, I did a piece by Jorge Sosa called Monkey. And it was, the story is primarily that of Journey to the West, which we realized on hindsight that the Wizard of Oz probably has its roots in. And of course, this is like a 14th century a saga that is now, one of those literary treasures that most people of Chinese heritage know about. And of course, the monkey god or Sun Wukong is the one that most people recognize in popular culture because he's this mischievous monkey god with this, amazing rod, and he can turn into 1,000 different characters and can shapeshift. That was a lot of fun. And the music was, informed by electronica, by Mexican rock, and featured some absolutely amazing singers.
Now, when we last talked, it was in the spring, and you were looking forward to a week or two off to set up your garden. And how did that garden turn out?
Actually, because we've had such weird weather, I've been talking to all my gardening friends, and everybody knows that the hydrangeas have been strange this year. It's like the top part just didn't kind of bloom for a lot of people. And the funny thing, of course, is that it's all blooming right now when we have this kind of, strange mid-fall summer. And then now we have the mid-fall winter, and then we're coming out. So my roses are blooming for the third time this season, because the season has been extended, and my hydrangeas are popping right now, which is very strange. They're the fall color and the bright purple, the blue purple of the hydrangeas going against all of that fall foliage.
That's great. Have you had time to tend the garden? Because you seem to be very busy with so many music projects.
I do. And, I think like many people who love gardens and flowers, I think that was something I thought about when I was planting. So I planted things that, were going to bloom in the early spring. So I had a lot of bulbs, a lot of daffodils, a lot of tulips. I think I planted about 1,600 tulips the first year in my garden. And they all bloom while I'm in Western Massachusetts, finishing my semester at Mount Holyoke. And then there is like a hiatus where there are far fewer blooms that are just kind of slowly simmering. And then usually I'm back in August, and that's where everything pops again. So my garden is a kind of April, May, and August garden.
That's great. What's happening with Pioneer Valley Symphony this season? You must have a series of concerts up and coming there.
Yeah, actually, we just finished our season opener, and that was just absolutely fabulous with local pianist Jia Yan Sun on the piano playing Rachmaninoff Piano Concerto No. 3. We hope to be able to share that online at some point in the future with everyone. And then right now, what's coming up in November is a program that's centered on Beethoven's Symphony No. 6. Which is the Pastorella, of course, and also featuring local artist Eric Berlin, who's also on the faculty of UMass Amherst, and we're presenting the Haydn Trumpet Concerto. So for all the folks that have written to us to say that we miss wind and brass music featured on the symphony orchestra stage, here we are with a local hero, Eric Berlin, who's going to be absolutely stunning. And actually, I'm not personally conducting that concert. My colleague, Neda Hadari, who was our assistant conductor a few years ago, is back for a reprise. And we love him so much. And I know the concert's going to be absolutely fabulous.
How many concerts are you doing in the course of the next couple of months in between Pioneer Valley Symphony and Boston and Mount Holyoke?
I'm on sabbatical from Mount Holyoke this year, so my dance card is a little lighter than usual. I know Mount Holyoke Symphony just completed a very much beloved tradition of a concert called Monsters Ball, and that was for Halloween, which is just behind us. I was not a part of that. But last season was particularly intense. I think, you know, I dare say maybe even a little bit more than is healthy for an individual to do, because I think I did some 30 plus individual programs, which is to say that I did almost a new program every week of the season. This year it's a lot better. I think I'm pacing myself out. So I have a new program out every 2 to 3 weeks.
Taking the sabbatical, does that just give you time to do the other stuff, or are you working on something special with that time?
Actually, I'm working on several projects. I am, you know, my eyes are already set on the 24-25 season. So I'm hard at work with a wonderful composer, Mary D. Watkins, who is based out in Oakland, California. And we're working on a new opera called Is This America? And it's going to show in Boston the second, third week of September, more or less just before kind of early ballots for the election coming up. And, you know, we thought that it was a particularly hopeful opera because this is the civil rights movement and the story is on the story of Fannie Lou Hamer. And one of the big things was the North and the South coming together to effect systemic change and positive change for civil rights and for voting rights in particular, and how important it is for all of us to go out and vote. So we thought, you know, we didn't want to shy away from the topic, and we actually wanted to go for that. And out in Pioneer Valley, we probably will be opening the season with, you know, an orchestral selections from the opera after the show in Boston. So it'll be coming right up in October before the election here in the Pioneer Valley. And, you know, it's going to be an important time for all of us. And, you know, as arts organizations, I think it's so important for us to establish that safe space and create that message of hope and make sure that, you know, we don't all kind of get worn down by the news cycle and just kind of go, oh, well, it really doesn't matter, because it really does.
And the arts are a great way to escape the news cycle.
Yes.
I mean, I've learned it's much easier to sit down and listen to music than it is to watch the news.
Yes, yes. And, you know, particularly right now, I mean, I think, you know, we are very sympathetic to what is happening, but it's such a complicated thing, you know, and news keeps emerging, and it's very, very wearying and really, really hard for most of us to kind of juggle with that kind of information with our daily lives. And, you know, I find it a relief in a way to work at it through the art. So for example, I'm presenting an opera on the festival Eid, of course, which is Arabic, and it depicts the story of a Muslim family. And you can hear the humanity in all of that, and the daily interactions, and also the kind of banter. But, you know, so the reality of our situation, but for the moment, we can focus on something beautiful and something that's about interpersonal relations.
Do you prefer working on contemporary new things versus classical things, or does each one resonate for you in a different way?
Well, you know, I see it as a continuum, actually, which is that, you know, in order for us in the 21st century to make sense of all these wonderful things that we've inherited, and, you know, and it's part of the tradition, it, you know, it is so much richer and it's so much deeper in engagement with that music if we're looking to see how it connects with our lives today. So I kind of see them kind of, you know, working hand in hand, really. And it's not, you know, so much a preference. You know, I'll give an example. For example, like, you know, in the last 30, 40 years, people have done a lot of research into the performance practice of music. And it's allowed us to kind of excavate how Rachmaninoff would have played Rachmaninoff, you know, what do some of the notations mean, circa 1910 versus our perspective today in 2023. So that's like a contemporary research thing that is influencing the way we hear stuff that's absolutely central to the repertoire. And I think it goes the other way around, which is that, you know, I think a lot of contemporary composers, the most successful ones, are often kind of mining this wonderful, rich heritage of expressivity, of technique, of beauty, to express ideas that are perhaps new today. So for example, I'm working on an opera by Avik Sarkar right now, and Avik is writing the story of a person transitioning to become a woman, and, you know, and talking openly about the emotional depth and the emotional pain and suffering for herself of what the process is. And interestingly, it's written from a South Indian perspective. So the music is infused to classical, Western classical music, but just a very, very authentic way of expressing her South Indian identity through that. And that's something that we didn't really deal with just 100 years ago. And so it's so great to be able to connect that, that tradition of Bizet, that tradition of Debussy into the present day with Avik Sarkar's music.
And it's a great, I think the arts are a great way to explain somebody's personal journey or experience in a way that becomes very accessible. It's not like watching a news story or reading a book.
Yes. Yes. I, you know, I think there's also something special. I mean, like, you know, we're doing something on the air right now, and there is a certain intimacy that comes with speaking with somebody so close and close mic. And then there's also something very special about entering a theater and then feeling the energy of both the performers and the audience. You know, like that depth of focus is really quite amazing. I always think of this, you know, when I talk with younger colleagues and my students, I say, you know, like what a privilege it is to contain, you know, to command the undivided attention of anybody today for, let's say, even a 20-minute piece. Right. That, you know, it is so rare that we give ourselves the permission to just kind of let our brains relax and unclench and just be with the energies and the music of these performers. And I find it deeply healing and deeply satisfying to be a part of that, not just as a performer, but also as an audience when I catch work by my colleagues.
You're right. There is something about it. It came to me during the pandemic when we were deprived of live performance. And one of the things I missed the most was going to a performance, whether it was theater or music or dance, and the interaction between the performers and the actors and the audience. And when you're in a theater and there's a vibe going back and forth from stage to audience and back, you can feel it. You can't describe it, but it makes that theater going experience so unique. And when I think back to all the shows I've seen over the years, I can remember going to see the musical Dreamgirls on Broadway the night at the second performance. So there wasn't word on the street about what it was about or anything like that. And Jennifer Holliday sings this song, "I'm Telling You I'm Not Going." And the audience was so in sync with her. I've never forgotten that, being a part of that experience. That can't be replicated when you stream something or you watch it on TV or listen to a recording. So for me, right, it's that live interaction. In a way, we're doing that now on the radio, but we don't have an audience that necessarily we're going to know how they react. But when we're in the theater or the concert hall and we're performing and the audience is there, you can feel it. If sometimes they're with you and sometimes they're not, but you know.
Yes, indeed. And, you know, like I think, you know, for example, of the Piney Valley Symphony's upcoming holiday concert, which has become such a tradition for Franklin County and for Greenfield as a city, and, you know, in, indeed the Piney Valley. I mean, last year we had almost a full house. You know, I think every single person felt, especially at special occasions like the holiday season, that they wanted to come together. They wanted to be together and to feel that incredible energy. And, you know, like, I think for me, this is also partly a reflection of my personal philosophy, because I think, you know, every day can be humdrum unless we make something of it. It's almost like a decision to, like, you know, like, say, for example, you wake up today and you decide, I'm going to bake a cake. And it's going to be fabulous. I'm going to sit down and eat it. And suddenly the whole day is transformed, right? And it's just the same. If you say to yourself, like, you know, today I'm going to go to the symphony. Today I'm going to go to the concert. And then the whole day your mind and your body is kind of in already working up towards anticipation of that, of sharing this time with friends and family, of being in the hall together and seeing everybody smiles and everybody clapping and everybody responding to the stuff happening on stage. It's really quite special.
You spend so much time in the concert hall, either rehearsing or performing. Do you get to go to other people's concerts, and do you have the same reactions that audience members have when you go see somebody else perform?
Yes, this is something I have always insisted to myself, you know, like I, you know, this can be the curse of a musician, right? The more training you get, the more you hear. And then, you know, as a conductor, sometimes my job is just to do error detection. And so my ears are going like, oh, that's the wrong note. Oh, that's a misplaced voice. Oh, that's an instrument that didn't quite, you know, place the bow properly, et cetera. But, you know, I've always said to myself, like, if I can no longer do that, then it's probably time to stop, because my love of music is greater than just being a critic, you know, and I definitely enjoy hearing what my colleagues are doing. And in fact, you know, that's kind of like one of the key things of my sabbatical. You know, in addition to, you know, working on a few projects, I am always trying to fill it with performances. So, you know, the last time I actually took, I spent a month in Berlin, and I caught 2 performances a day. So I caught like 50 something performances in over the course of a month, because, you know, it's so interesting to hear how everybody as artists, how they're responding to this particular moment in history. And is the response to play a Bach cello suite? And if it's to play Bach, you know, how do you communicate to your audiences? You know, how does it connect with the human experience right now? And I'm constantly learning, and I'm constantly inspired. And I think, you know, to not do that for myself would actually represent a huge lack. I would be kind of semi-depressed not to be able to hear the work of others out in the field.
Do you find a need every once in a while to get away from music altogether?
Actually, daily. Because, you know, one of the ways in which I've noticed this amongst, and I share this with a lot of my colleagues and friends who are in music, is that, you know, because I'm working so intently on sound, it's often the case that when I have free time, I might drive for 4 hours with not anything on the radio at all. Because it's almost like my brain needs that time to unspool all of the music that it's been kind of accumulating over the course of the day. And there is a moment where it comes where I finally experience quiet. It's like my brain has, you know, finally played enough, you know, has kind of like processed subconsciously all the music I've heard. And then I have this peace and quiet. So, you know, I find one of my favorite things to do is to go for walks, you know. So you can, you know, probably find me hiking out in the hills and off Western Massachusetts quite often.
I'm the same way. I need to blank out. And when I'm coming to the studio to do radio, I've got a 20-minute drive. So the radio's not on in the car. And I just look at the foliage changing, or, you know, I know certain trees along the way, and I blank out. And it's the best thing I can do for myself, because I feel like I'm supercharged the rest of the day.
Yes. Yes. And in my case, you know, even if the radio is off, the truth is my head is going, you know, I'm still playing back parts of the symphony I was just rehearsing, or I'm seeing this particularly, you know, like when you're driving on the 91, you cross over to Vermont, and then there's this like opening up, and you see the deep valleys there. For example, my brain like starts playing Mahler. You know, it starts playing Bruckner, like, you know, and I enjoyed that moment. And it's like my brain is taking exactly what it needs from this memory of music, and just enjoying that moment with the perfect soundtrack. I don't need the radio, you know, like, but there will be times when I, you know, when all of that has done its job and everything is silent, and I actually crave to hear something, often on very long vacations, that happens. And I really enjoy that moment too, because it refreshes my kind of hunger to hear music. And I, you know, I still remember as a kid, all those firsts. The first time I sat on the front row, I watched a Schubert octet playing a version of Fechtelnacht in Dartington, and I'm calling up Dartington in the UK because they're going through some things this week. And it was absolutely transformative. Like, you know, I remember the moment when everybody struck the string at the same time. and how it was a visceral feeling, you know, and I still remember how refreshed my body was, you know, just because I had never encountered that before. And the first time I encountered it was life-changing. So that moment where I've had enough silence that I feel kind of my palate has been cleansed, so that even just a little bit of sugar makes a huge difference. That's kind of what it is like for me and listening.
Do you ever listen to contemporary music or rock or blues or jazz, or do you pretty much stick in the classical genre?
Oh, lots of it, actually. And if you will, kind of like not chronologically analogous, because, you know, like I'm just such a curious person. So a few years ago, a friend of mine introduced me to the great Mexican singer Natalia Lafourcade. And, you know, and this was, you know, because I was working with so many Puerto Rican friends and colleagues, I wanted to hear the pop music that they were listening to at that moment, right? And that just became like the soundtrack for like years. Was introduced to Solamente Una Vez by Jorge Sosa when he was, you know, writing something for Mount Holyoke, or the rock music. And most recently, I've been kind of listening to Madre Deus, which is this kind of folk rock. They do a lot of things that don't quite fit categories either. And they are from Portugal. So I listened to a lot of rock, pop, and jazz from all over the place. And there was one point in time where I was listening to a lot of Turkish techno, which was a trip.
Now, there was one point in my career where I was in Paris for work and I stayed with a friend and I was listening to French rap. And I don't know why I got into it, but there were certain songs and you'd hear them on the metro and things. And it was just a new world for me. I don't listen to that. I don't listen to that anymore. But so in the next few months, if people want to see you conduct, where do they have to go?
So coming right up, the next show that I'm doing is in Boston, and it's called Let's Celebrate, and it features four different operas celebrating different things. One celebrates Eid, one celebrates the coming together of Mexican and Chinese cultures, one celebrates a person's transition, and I'm momentarily blanking on one that it will come back to me. So those four things are going to be right here in Boston, November 18th. And then we have the Pioneer Valley Symphony will be doing its holiday concert, and that will be up in Greenfield in December. So look out for that as well. You can find us at tvsoc.org. There is an education concert of the New England Philharmonic where I'm presenting a reprise of Jordan Cusper's The Mystery of the Missing Music that was premiered out in Western Mass and has a reference to the poet's seat out here as well.
Well, that's great. That's great. But you have the year off from Mount Holyoke and you're going to have all the opera projects in Boston as well. Will they be recorded? Mm-hmm. The celebration things, will they be recorded or live streamed?
They will be. And, you know, I can't really disclose much except to just to say that we're exploring a partnership with some platforms so that we can actually begin to release our growing catalog of incredible new work. Because so many people have wanted to watch this. The equivalent that we did last year was actually released in partnership with GBH Music and was actually presented as a TV show with four different episodes. Yes, I remember the fourth piece now. Oh my goodness, I can't believe it. It's by Ivan Rodriguez, My Little Cookie. And like people in Western Mass might recognize this from my El Puerto Rico project, The Victory Players. And, you know, he wrote us a piece exploring Puerto Rican identity. But My Little Cookie, for people who know this, cookie are little frogs that are native to Puerto Rico. And this is a legend surrounding that. And it's so kind of reflective of Ivan's incredible artistry that he's able to weave in what is ultimately a beguiling, almost childlike story. And then you realize he's talking about a lot more. He's talking about Puerto Rican identity. He's talking about our reactions to climate change and all of it wrapped in this absolutely gorgeous, lush and luscious music.
Well, T, and we're out of time, but I want to thank you for coming on the program today and being the first guest I've ever had who's behind the wheel in Greater Boston while you're at it. I hope our paths cross when you get back to Western Massachusetts.
Yes, indeed. Thank you again for having me on the show, Mark.
It's been terrific. And this wraps up another edition of Arts Beat. We've been talking with Tuyen He Ning, who's the director of the Pioneer Valley Symphony Orchestra and does all kinds of great work all around. And Peter Coles has been our chief engineer. I'm Mark Auerbach. We'll see you next Friday with another edition of Arts Beat.